characters developed from a humour column. It really was quite, actually, if I was a thin-skinned man, I would say insulting, but I have had a couple of novels published, which I think I have remarked, soared to instant obscurity. And I had 90,000 words of these columns, and I said to my editor in Toronto, would you ever consider clapping my columns between covers and maybe make a buck or two? And do any of you know about Lake Wobegon? Yeah. Well, she says to me, well, Taylor, if your name was Garrison Keillor, the implication being is who the hell's ever heard of you, Sonny? I would, but then she said a nice thing. She said, I like O'Reilly. Could you write me a novel about him? And that's how the whole damn thing goes. And here I am. Thank you. Thank you. Now, questions?
I'm curious about your writing practices.
Sorry, Nick, I'm a bit...
I'm curious about your writing practices.
My writing practices?
Victor Hugo was noted for writing stark naked at the lectern. I'm wondering if you have any strange behaviours during
your... Well, I'll tell you one thing, boy. I don't stick my manuscripts in envelopes and expect people to open them. No. Very simple man. I get up in the morning and we have breakfast and I sit down about 10 o'clock and I usually deal with my email and administrative stuff, get it out of the way, and I usually write about 2,000 words a day, and the next thing I'll do is edit that, and that'll go away for a while. I just tidy it up and make sure I've got cat spelled C-A-T, not K-A-T, things like that. And then I stare at the screen, and when beads of blood start to film, you know, my forehead, I start typing. I'll do that about 1:30 and have my lunch, and go back to work about 2 and pack it up about 5. And I do that 7 days a week if I'm here. And latterly, we've been going away for part of the winter, and so when we were in, I don't know, somewhere in Arizona, like I couldn't find with a GPS and a microscope, but we were there. I did some work there as well. That's my standard writing. It's not very dramatic.
If you don't have a computer, are you allowed to use a pen?
Oh no, I just use a word processor. Nick, I was a doctor. Can you read a doctor's writing? I can't read my own handwriting. Now, I have...
Patrick, apart from the medical practice, which has changed a lot over the time.
Yeah.
You're trying to fit into the countryside that was also quite different in those days. So, I know you do a lot of work in keeping up with the medical research going back. Do you also have to do the same with the local areas and dialects and things?
Well, again, it's very much yes and no, John. How old were you when you left the North? Roughly.
25?
I was 30. The act, the speech of the people of the 60s, remember, I'm not writing contemporaneously, was exactly the same as the way I speak to you today, only more so. And I'm sure you remember all the old expressions like, your man there looks like the sidewall of a house. I mean, he's big. And that just goes in there. The countryside, my little corner of County Down and Strangford Loch, where I used to go wildfowling with my father, I could, from memory, tell you every blade of grass there. It's in there, you know. When it came to Dublin, we had to visit Dublin many times. I had to go to Trinity College. I'd never been there. I had to go to the Royal College of Surgeons. I had to go to the Rotunda Maternity Hospital. I bought a fantastic book called Dublin Tenement Life. I have several collections of photographs of downtown Dublin in the 30s. The Dublin speech hasn't changed radically, you know, everything's feckin' this and feckin' that, and it's old. They all talk down their noses doing that, and that around her, Jacks. And you mustn't get upset with the F word in Dublin. Feckin' this in Dublin, it's the way a teenage girl in this country says like every third or fourth word. You can even hyphenate it. I was awful sick, doctor, I die a feckin' rea. I told my Canadian, born in Ireland, daughter, do you know what she said? Ah, Dad, she says, that's spectacular. So, I've been fairly lucky picking up on dialect and accents. My big challenge at the moment, as the vessel no longer exists, I can tell you literally how many times HMS Warspite was hit by German shells and of what caliber in the Battle of Jutland in 1915. I can tell you precisely what time and where on her starboard side she was hit by a 500-pound bomb in the Kythera Channel off Crete in 1941. But can I get my hands on what this medical establishment was? How many doctors and how many sick birth attendants? It's murder, and I'm going around in circles on that. So it's a long-winded answer, but I hope it answers for you.
Thank you.
But that's how I work. Okay. Hold on time. Yes, ma'am.
Why did you leave Ireland?
Why did I leave Ireland? You have to ask the RUC about that. No. The system I worked in, it's not like Canada. If you qualify as a doctor, a specialist in Canada, you apply for hospital privilege and you hang up your plate. There you go. Ireland was an hierarchical structure. There were so many positions in the hospital as specialists, and you can't be a specialist, not in a hospital. I was temporarily, and I mean in the sense of time, very unlucky. There was a huge phalanx of men, and it was men in those days, who'd come home from the Second World War. My own father was one of them. In 1946, and they were all young men, and they weren't going to retire for another 20 years. And I would have stayed the equivalent of a specialist resident for maybe 10 years. And I'd been lucky enough to come to Canada and do a locum for a GP. I thought Canada was a wonderful country, and I had been offered a position in Ontario, and so I decided to take it. Concurrently, we were indulging in Ireland's national sport, shooting each other. And contrary to popular belief, like the First World War, that it would be over by Christmas, I was convinced it wasn't going to be over for quite a while. And regrettably, I was proven right. So that's why I came to Canada, and I've had no reason to regret it, but I did go back and live in Ireland for a couple of years recently. Another interesting experience. Have you got it?
What was the treatment for your polio?
My polio? Oh.
You alluded to that a little while ago.
Oh, yeah. There wasn't any. They put you to bed and you weren't allowed to move because there was some hard evidence that the muscle groups that were most severely affected were the ones that you moved most. And when I went home and told my father I had a blinding headache, I mean, he just said, don't move. And I was very lucky. The other boys, and I'll never forget, some of you may be old enough to remember iron lungs. And it's one of the most eerie things. These were the old Florence Nightingale wards with 20 beds on each side. And up the middle were a row of these massive iron cylinders, with the little boy's head sticking out the top. And bellows at the side going, 24 hours a day. And you'd wake up in the morning, and one of the little boys wasn't there anymore. It was a pretty grim time, and I'm not much of a proselytizer, but boy, when I hear people saying, I will not have my child immunized because I'll strengthen their immune system naturally, I want to strangle them. It's child abuse not to have a child immunized against infection. I've seen children die of diphtheria. I've treated active tuberculosis. They are preventable diseases. Sorry, I didn't mean it. We'll get back to the humor of it, but you pressed the wrong button. Anyway, I was going to read, but I'll read you another little bit here. Perhaps apropos of the question you asked, ma'am, about the troubles in the north of Ireland. Right? By the way,